Welcome to Get Rich Education. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. Amazon is selling houses for less than $20,000 with free shipping. Does this mean that your properties will lose value? Then the highest cash-on-cash return investment we've ever discussed before today on Get Rich Education. MC Lobster is the host of the Cashflow Ninja podcast and president of Producers Wealth. He is on a mission to help you achieve financial independence and freedom as soon as possible. He achieves this by integrating the infinite banking concept with real estate investments to increase your returns and recapture cash flow that you are not even aware of that you're losing. MC shares the number one strategy of investors in his holistic wealth creation course at yourownbankingsystem.com. Finally, Total Control Financial gives you checkbook control of your 401k and IRA money to invest in real estate. It's time to get your retirement money into your own checking account, but you've got to avoid the little-known tax that you'll pay with any self-directed IRA. Instead, it's time for the QRP. Learn more and get your free copy of the QRP book by text messaging QRP in all capital letters to 72,000.
You're listening to the show that has created more financial freedom than nearly any show in the world. This is Get Rich Education.
Welcome to GRE. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold, and you are inside Get Rich Education, episode 245. Amazon is selling entire houses for less than $20,000 with free shipping, or so the MarketWatch headline reads. Does this mean that your $150,000 Kansas City or Tampa rental property, or even your own primary residence, will lose its value soon? No, that is not very likely. Once you read beyond their splashy headline, you'll see that these prefabricated homes have additional costs and major downsides. Now, prefabricated, that just means that a home was built in a factory and not out on site. Often, these additional costs and downsides are really the same reason that China's famed 3D printed homes have not disrupted real, durable, livable housing. 3D printed homes are built by depositing successive layers of concrete on top of each other. Well, these prefabricated homes bought through Amazon, they are tiny. Some are as small as 172 square feet, up to 300 square feet or a little more. Do you want penetrations and utility hookups? Most people find electricity and running water as pretty convenient amenities. Well, that costs extra. How about insulation? Well, that costs extra too. Often you'll hire an architect to make this prefabbed housing permanent. Then one thing that your architect or engineer would probably recommend is a foundation. Well, constructing the foundation is another extra. And on top of all that, you might have to assemble these homes yourself. One manufacturer that sells through Amazon concedes that their model is better suited as a structure for your hobby, garden, or pool supplies. So tiny homes, 3D printed homes, or these prefabricated homes have some major limitations and livability problems. The way that a permanent livable new home is constructed today is basically that first, the contractor does the dirt work. They prepare the construction site and pour the foundation. That's how it typically works. And then they construct rough framing. Next, they complete the rough plumbing, electrical, and HVAC work. Then the insulation is installed. That's the point at which they complete drywall and interior textures and start on the exterior finishes. Then they'll finish the interior trim and install exterior driveways and walkways. Next, they'll install hard surface flooring and countertops and complete the exterior grading. Then, as they're nearly done, they'll finish mechanical trims and install the bathroom fixtures. By now, they're down to installing mirrors and shower doors and finished flooring, and then they'll finish the exterior landscaping, including spreading topsoil on the grounds, and then it's ready for the final walkthrough with the builder. Now, that right there, a lot of those same operations, need to take place on a prefabbed or a 3D home. And, you know, there is just no escaping the fact that all home types involve substantial costs of materials and labor. And here's the real thing. Be mindful that any home, including a prefabricated or a 3D printed home, also means that the owner needs to buy the land upon which to set the structure. Beyond the improved structure, there is always a land cost, regardless of what structure sits on top of it. With some quick news items from the real estate world, mortgage interest rates recently hit 21-month lows. Yes, these are indeed the lowest mortgage rates since late 2017. And what are these low rates attributed to? There are signs that job growth is slowing, and there are also these ongoing trade war concerns. So now, if you're wondering, why do those signs of economic uncertainty translate to lower mortgage interest rates anyway? What's the correlation there? Well, uncertainty means that people buy bonds for safety. That strength in the bond market means higher bond prices. Bond prices and bond yields have an inverse relationship. That means when bond prices go higher like this due to uncertainty, bond yields go lower, and long-term mortgage interest rates are tied to bond yields, specifically that all-important yield on the 10-year Treasury note. Now, as for price growth in the United States housing market, the NAR predicts housing prices will rise 3% over the next year. Fannie Mae's prediction is 4%. The Mortgage Bankers Association predicts housing prices will appreciate 4.2%. CoreLogic says home prices will increase 4.7% over the next year. That's up from 3.6% over the past year. Well, why the price increases? Well, Frank Notaff, chief economist for CoreLogic, he summed it up pretty well. It's partly due to lower mortgage rates and higher incomes. Those factors both increase affordability, but that's not the entire story. Price growth has remained the highest for lower-priced homes, and that's still keeping affordability out of reach for a lot of first-time homebuyers. This is partly what Logan Modishami and I discussed last week. Prices are expected to rise, but pretty mildly. There are so many more factors that go into prices than just what interest rates are. So among those four sources, the NAR, Fannie Mae, the Mortgage Bankers Association, and CoreLogic, that's a blended average and a consensus of about a 4% appreciation rate going ahead. Of course, to you, the leverage investor, if you've got 25% equity positions across your portfolio, meaning you're leveraged 4-to-1, you will project a 16% increase in your equity position. An investor that has their properties paid off, they would only enjoy that same 4% appreciation rate on their equity because they have lost their leverage. 2 weeks ago, we discussed the best real estate investing websites and apps. Rarely have I ever received such a strong response here as we did about the number of you that wrote in about Stessa.com. S-T-E-S-S-A is a free software for rental property owners for income and expense tracking, tax-ready financials, a reporting dashboard, and it allows you to enter information for your rental properties and also connect your bank account and your property manager software to automatically pull in and categorize your transactions. With Stessa, you start with the property address, and it populates the basic info for that property if it can find it online. And from what I can see with checking it out a little bit, you then enter the rest of the info, the mortgage balance, your insurance, your rent income, your renter's information, and some other property specifications. And at the end, you can graphically see your portfolio performance as a whole or property by property. And that way you can see, for example, how your cash flow compares with your pro forma. That's Stessa.com. Thanks for the great listener feedback there. Now, you can probably buy a rental single-family home all by yourself, all on your own. Well, the real asset investor, Dave Zook, he's a friend of mine, and he helps people get into investments that they could not otherwise do on their own. Now, I recently talked to Dave about coming onto the show, and I wanted him to feature his one singular investment that has been the most successful one over the years, as measured by the number of repeat investors that he has that keep coming back for it. That's what we're talking about today. And not coincidentally, it's also the real asset investment that provides the highest cash-on-cash return, the highest of them all. So it's no wonder why investors keep coming back for more. Then we're talking about the opportunity for you to invest in your own lot of ATMs. Yes, automated teller machines. A small piece of real estate, I guess, even smaller than a tiny quasi-home that you can buy through Amazon. And it provides giant cash flow. These ATMs provide a stable cash-on-cash return of 24.5%. It is a cash flow and tax-centric investment, though, as your ATMs at the end of their 7-year service contract have almost no economic value remaining. Let's talk about it. I'd like to welcome back onto the show a guest that we haven't had here for nearly 3 years. Since his last appearance, you might see the hashtag 100 million next to his name as he successfully raised more than $100 million for real estate and related projects. Congratulations there. As you've demonstrated such trust and a good track record for your investors, welcome back to Get Rich Education, the real asset investor, Dave Zook.
Keith, it doesn't seem like 3 years. Thanks for having me back.
It's astounding how that happens. Dave is from Pennsylvania, like I am originally, so we have a connection there. One recent trip, I toured one of your businesses in downstate Pennsylvania, and then last year, we went hiking together in upstate Pennsylvania, and funny how that works. As soon as people heard you and I wanted to go on a hike together, a whole bunch of these interested investors came along, so that was pretty cool. Dave, we're here to talk about cash and ATMs, and it's really pretty surprising. As you might have guessed, you, the listener, the use of cash is greater at the lower income levels, and it often seems inconceivable, but many consumers will pay a $2 to $3 ATM surcharge just to get access to a $20 bill. So therefore, owning ATMs can be extremely profitable and generate a steady cash flow stream from a real asset. And ATMs have been around for 50 years, but there's really a great misconception about ATMs, and that's that cash use is declining, and consequently, ATM uses is as well. And until last year, I admit that I had also thought this way, but that's not true at all. Tell us more about that.
The general conception is typically if you've got enough of money to invest in an ATM machine, you're not an ATM machine user.
Right.
The lower income folks use this a lot. In fact, I had one of my investors tell me that I never used an ATM machine. Why would I invest in them? According to the Federal Reserve's own report, the use of cash went up by almost 5% in 2018, just last year. Me looking in from the outside, and the way I use cash and the way I use credit cards and some of the other payments, methods of payment, it would seem to me that the use of cash is declining because I keep using it less and less.
Right.
But I think the most important thing is to figure out, okay, who is my avatar? Who's my customer? And that's important in any business, not just the ATM business. So once you recognize who your primary customer is, then it starts making a lot more sense. I mean, look, 10 years ago, there used to be a factory worker that worked for a paycheck. And on Friday nights, he would take his paycheck to the bank and he would deposit the check. And then he would take out some cash to hold him over for the week. That doesn't happen anymore. That gets that paycheck gets ACH right straight into his bank account. So now picture this. You've got, here you come, you get home from work on a Friday night. You walk out of your C-class apartment building and you walk down to the corner deli. And right there sits an ATM machine. That's where you get your cash. You're not going to drive 3, 4, 5 miles across town to get to the bank and then stand in line to get your $20, $50, $100 out of your account. You're going to spend $2 or $3 and you're going to get your cash out for that week. Some of those things and just realizing who your typical customer is kind of makes it a whole lot easier to understand when you realize that, look, there's people using cash and lots of it.
Some people say, well, I can't relate to the ATM user because that's not me. But in the same vein, you are profitable as an investor, just like you are profitable as a business owner when you best understand your customer and the needs of that customer. So as real estate investors, and me as an investor myself, in my Class C multifamily apartment buildings, I can't really relate to renting a 900 square foot place for $900 a month. It's 2-bed, 1-bath, and has few amenities. I can't really relate myself to living in a small Class B single family rental with very few amenities, but I know that that's where the demand is and that's what my customer needs. Just like there's a substantial population of unbanked and underbanked people that need cash from an ATM. So oftentimes you got to think about your tenant that's a cargo warehouse manager that makes $50,000 a year in Indiana and think about the kind of housing they need and think about how they interact with money. It's probably different than how you and I interact with money. And there are some headwinds for cash use in the United States, for sure. But the maturity of things like Apple Pay and Square, PayPal, Bitcoin, they have not stopped cash from being a growth business. And this is corroborated by outlets from the USA Today to CNBC. 42 billion notes with a value of $1.7 trillion, the most in history, are in circulation. So those are some huge numbers. What does that really mean, relatively speaking? Well, that total grows almost 5% per year. That's substantially faster than the U.S. population grows in a year. From 2008 to 2016, in those 8 years, the volume of currency in circulation has increased 43%, and that's straight from the director of the Bureau of Engraving and Printing. The frequency of cash use, that's remained pretty unchanged in recent years. About one-third of all transactions are cash, and more than half of those are those smaller ones under $25. Overall, cash is the most frequent method of payment in the entire United States today. That's more than electronic, more than credit, more than debit, and more than checks.
And I would guess that that's true even more so in the rest of the world, Keith, not just the United States.
Yeah, and there is substantial demand from foreign countries for U.S. dollars, cash, green bills. That's accepted in almost every country. I travel internationally pretty regularly, just like you, and greenbacks are recognized and accepted almost everywhere.
That is correct.
Now, cash use is consistent across most U.S. household income levels, but it does increase significantly at lower incomes. Fully 30% of U.S. households are either unbanked or underbanked.
Yeah, and again, just realizing real estate investors, ATM investors, people who have cash to invest, I know it's easy for us to kind of forget what it's like to not be like us. Right. You know, what's it like to not be like me? So I sort of live in this bubble of I'm used to living life the way I live life. But when you get outside of that and you see how some people live and how maybe a majority of the people live in the United States, you come to understand. And then if you track that pattern and you do your homework, I mean, it becomes pretty easy to figure out why this model makes sense.
And of course, most people cannot relate to being a $100 million man. So that's pretty cool. But I hope you're not losing your relatability there, Dave.
Not at all. Not at all. I have stayed pretty close to my roots.
He is really down to earth. Last year, CNBC published an article with the headline, "The Cashless Society Myth. PayPal, Square, and Bitcoin have not stopped cash from being a growth business." And in that article, it let us know that just last year, PayPal CEO, so this is someone that is here to promote his electronic payment business, the PayPal CEO, Dan Schulman, told the New York Times that, quote, "I would never predict the death of cash over the next decade or two. I think cash is going to be with us for a long time to come." Yes, that's from the PayPal CEO. Another electronic payment system, Venmo, their COO, Michael Vaughn. Venmo is owned by PayPal, by the way. But Michael Vaughn spoke last year at a Wharton Business School conference at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. And he said, quote, "It is still decades and decades and decades. It's going to take our lifetime and our kids' lifetime before you start to see this work itself out," meaning that before cash dies. The CEO of Brinks, you probably know Brinks as the armored truck company, Doug Pertz, he recently spoke about how federal regulation requires that all banks have a certain amount of cash available same day, and they don't do that with cryptocurrency or Venmo. They do that with cash, green bills, dead presidents.
2012, when I first got into this space, there was a lot of talk about the use of cash, cash being in decline, cashless society. That was 7 years ago. The use of cash of that has actually increased substantially since then. We've gone through a whole cycle of ATM contracts. Our contracts are set up on 7-year contracts. So we've gone through a whole cycle now, and the use of cash has only strengthened. There's a lot of talk out there about cashless society. 7 years ago, there was a lot of talk about cashless society as well. And there's more cash in circulation and certainly more cash being used today than it was back in 2012, 7 years ago.
Yeah, it's a bit counterintuitive to some people. And world events, that can sometimes send a sudden reminder about cash's critical role in the everyday economy. Look at Puerto Rico, where all the ATMs went down for days post-hurricane while Brinks rushed in with truckloads of cash. They had to do that to help society continue to operate. So we're talking about the unbanked and the underbanked population. That is 45 million Americans that make up that population. That's the number of people that don't have access to payment systems other than cash. Now, me in my life, personally, I don't use ATMs too often. In my life, I still do get people that write me paper checks. And the way I usually process those paper checks is using my bank's mobile app to go ahead and take a photograph of that check and electronically deposit it. Other times, I might exceed my limit as to how much I can deposit with my phone. Many banks impose limits on that. So at that time, I do have to go to an ATM to insert and deposit those paper checks. Other times, while I'm at that ATM depositing those paper checks, I do pull cash out of there once in a while. I do use an ATM from time to time. I bank at one of the major banks everyone's heard of. For a while, the limit that I could withdraw in any one visit or day was $300. For some reason, they bumped that up to $800. And sometimes I still use ATMs to get cash for gifts. The ATM usually gives me $20. Sometimes I'll go into the bank teller to get a bunch of crisp hundreds, typically to give as gifts. Dave, when you have a business named Get Rich Education, people expect more than $20 as a gift. That's kind of one of the downsides of the name of Get Rich Education here. Tell us about how you use ATMs, if you do at all. I know you said you don't use them very often. And again, we're not the typical user.
I can't remember the last time I used an ATM machine. I think I was in some foreign country when I last tried to get some cash from an ATM machine. But no, it's been years ago. You just mentioned some of the things you can do with an ATM machine now that you couldn't even do 5 years ago. So you can get gift cards now. You can deposit your checks. There's a lot of things that you'll be able to do 2, 3, 4 years from now that you can't do with an ATM right now. We have pilot programs. We're doing beta testing with a bunch of different new uses for ATM machines. Some of those are under NDA, but there's a lot of things coming down the pike for ways that you can use an ATM that you can't use them for today.
Tell us about some of those things that either exist currently on services that ATMs offer or that might be coming in the future, because I think a lot of us only think about withdrawing green bills, something that people don't do as often as they used to, or depositing paper checks like I do. Tell us about some of those other capabilities that ATMs have or soon should.
Some of the things that I can talk about, I mean, you mentioned gift cards. That's a revenue stream. Marketing. All of our machines that go out now have a high-end video topper. Just thinking about an oversized tablet. Those are installed on top of our ATM machines, and they run ads. And you can market for big companies, say Coca-Cola, or you can market for the person that owns the real estate where your ATM is sitting on. Like you can, let's say he has a deli and he's running a special on a 6-inch sub and a drink. You can market to those people, and there's all kinds of sophisticated stuff in those video toppers. You can monitor the way a person looks at the machine. You know, if he's walking past, you can figure out, okay, for so many people that walk past, here's how much impressions we're getting from that foot traffic. Another thing is, think about the old Western Union model. Let's say you're from Mexico and you're sending your paycheck home to your family, and one of the big three banks is taking 10% or 15% of your paycheck in order to get that money down to your family. What if you could use an ATM machine and spend $2 or $3 to get that done? There are things in the works. We're currently beta testing a bunch of different marketing streams. We're beta testing crypto compatible machines where you can actually swap crypto for cash or cash for crypto. I mean, there's things that are ATMs will be used for in the future that we haven't even thought of right now.
Again, ATMs have been around for 50 years. This is nothing new. There is a human interface there. So like with what Dave is telling us about, there is that opportunity for advertising and for promotion. Yes, it seems inconceivable, but many consumers will pay that $2 to $3 ATM surcharge just to get access to one $20 bill. That's where the profitable opportunity lies therein. You're listening to Get Rich Education. We're going to talk more about the investment opportunity when we come back. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. This is Get Rich Education.
Learn the easiest way to create wealth and passive income with real estate. Now you can access the best deals without the stress or hassle of having to find, renovate, or manage those investment properties. Narada Real Estate saves you time by providing you with passive income investment properties in some of the best U.S. markets. Learn more at PassiveRealEstateInvesting.com and download your free copy of The Ultimate Guide to Passive Real Estate Investing. There's no obligation and nothing to buy. Simply visit PassiveRealEstateInvesting.com.
For a real estate investor like you seeking an income property loan, go to Ridge Lending Group, NMLS 42056. Over the years, you've heard President Chaley Ridge generously devote her time to you here on the show as a guest. Ridge provides investment property loans in most U.S. states, and you're going to find out how they've helped more people realize their dreams of real estate financial freedom than any other mortgage lender in the entire nation when you get started at RidgeLendingGroup.com.
This is Rich Dad Advisor Ken McElroy. Listen to Get Rich Education with Keith Weinhold and don't quit your daydream.
Welcome back to Get Rich Education. We're talking with Dave Zook about the opportunity for you to invest in ATMs, automated teller machines. Dave, interestingly, not too long ago, some small retail stores had attempted to go cashless, and some jurisdictions have made that illegal, peeling that back and saying, no, you must accept cash. Tell us more.
Yeah, so that was Amazon stores, and you know, it all sounded like a great idea. You walk in there and get your stuff, and you walk right out the door, and you automatically get charged for it to your account. Sounded great, but they are under some pretty heavy pressure in a number of different cities that they, you know, you can't do that. You can't exclude or discriminate against the underserved, underprivileged. So yeah, they're bringing cash back to those stores. So I thought that was interesting. That was an article you and I discussed here just in the last few weeks.
Right. We had found that so interesting. Some jurisdictions, Philadelphia and New Jersey specifically, are the ones that made laws repealing that, saying that you must accept cash. Your transactions cannot be electronic only because, again, you're shutting out this population of unbanked and underbanked people. And Dave, you offer a lot of different investments to people, self-storage, apartment buildings, ATM lots, and other things. But you've told me that ATMs are the number one repeat offering that you have. In fact, you're now actually in the top 10 of investment offerings in the United States for ATMs.
We're the seventh largest ATM operator in the United States right now and growing. There's your top three. You know, you got the Cardtronics of the world, big billion-dollar companies, but we're number seven right now. And so, yeah, I mean, we've gotten a lot of momentum. There's more people, more investors came back to me for the second, third, fourth, fifth, tenth time to invest in ATMs and any other asset class that I've ever been involved in. And when you get that first unit of ATMs and you see how it works and see how seamless it is and see how much sense it makes, and it doesn't have the hair attached to this asset class that you may get from a C-class multifamily. So people appreciate that and they keep coming back for more.
Some people don't realize that banks often do not own their own ATMs unless it's at the bank's physical location. So you have the opportunity to invest in your own lot of ATMs. And really, I think the attraction and the thing that's given you the repeat investors is that this is a cash flow centric investment. Your cash flow can be substantial. But before we talk about the cash flow and the income, what's the minimum? What does it take for someone to get in?
For someone to invest in ATMs with us, it's $104,000 minimum investment. And then from there on out, they're in $104,000 increments. $104,000 gets you seven ATM machines. So your minimum investment, seven ATM machines, $104,000.
And what is the hold time?
7 years. And this is very different from investing in, say, multifamily or self-storage. You're investing in a cash flow stream and a tax benefit. And the ATM machine is simply a vehicle to get you those two benefits. So it's very similar to, let's say, buying a vehicle, let's say a truck, and running it coast to coast for 7 years. At the end of 7 years, the value of that asset is almost nothing, but you've made a lot of money in the process. So it's very similar to that. When you calculate your cash on cash returns, this is one of the few asset classes where your internal rate of return is lower than your cash on cash return. And the reason for that is just simply because over that 7 year period, you're losing the value of that asset. So you got a really strong cash on cash return. You got 24.5% wow. cash on cash return. But then when you jump to an internal rate of return, which considers your cash flow, your tax impact, and the loss of value of your equipment, now you're at about an 18.5% return.
Now that's a paradigm shift. Usually with residential real estate investing, your cash on cash return is just one component that goes into your internal rate of return. And I kind of think of the internal rate of return as one's total rate of return. But in this case, it's different. Your cash on cash return, 24.5%, which is phenomenal, is greater than your internal rate of return of 18.5%. And that's because after 7 years of you owning these seven different ATMs, the value of it basically goes down to about nothing. I think you told me that you can get a little bit out of it. What, $1,400 when you sell? Is that per ATM or is that for all seven?
That's for all seven. Now, we projected it at $1,400, but we're actually getting, and I've been in this game long enough that I've went through a full cycle now. And at the end of the cycle, it was, I think I got like 2,500 and change. I mean, still in the grand scheme of things, it's really nothing, but we did exceed our pro forma, which is fun.
Right. So $104,000 minimum investment, and you might get $1,000 or $2,000 or a little bit more than that when you go to sell them. They basically don't have any value. This is a cash flow play. So let's talk about that income stream. That's what we're in this for. What is the monthly payment amount that goes into every investor's account electronically monthly?
So on the 25th of the month, you'll get a distribution into your account via ACH for
$2,125. $2,125. And that's a predictable monthly income stream with no volatility at all. How do they even that out so that every investor gets $2,125 monthly for 7 years?
So there's a couple of things. One is after you make the purchase of your ATMs, we then roll those ATMs into a fund and you get paid out a blended return from the fund. So let's say your ATMs, because just imagine this. I mean, if you've got ATMs on the boardwalk in New Jersey on the beach, and it's right beside is, you know, some big food court. That ATM is going to be used, you know, probably five times more than an ATM in the front entrance of the mall or somewhere like that. So what we've done is we've figured out a way how to make it fair for everybody that's in the fund. My ATM that I have that I own personally isn't going to outperform yours. So that's one thing. So we pay out a blended distribution in the fund. The other thing is the way that we've really made it to where there's no volatility is we commit to the investor, the management team commits to the investor that, look, every month you're going to get 3,373 transactions. And for each of those transactions, your portion of the surcharge revenue is 63 cents. So take 63 cents times 3,373 transactions, you come up with that $2,125 number. So let's run a scenario. Let's say month one. Transaction volume, it's low. Let's say it's whatever, January or February, kind of maybe off season. Tourist travel has slowed down. Let's say your transaction volume is 3,200. Management kicks in a portion of their surcharge revenue to bring you up to 3,373. Let's say now it goes into May and tourist season picks up, you know, people are traveling. Let's say your transaction volume across the portfolio hit 3,500 per unit. Well, when it clears 3,373, management keeps the upside. So you got sort of a preferred return method. We've put something in place to where you don't have to wonder, look, am I going to get 1,500 a month for the next 2 months? And then 2 months after that, I'm going to get 3,500. We've made it so that we take the brunt of that volatility and it does not flow through to the investors.
So with that $2,125 in a predictable monthly income stream, how long does it take an investor for them to get the return of principal investment back? Not return on principal, but just the return of principal, their $104K back.
When you consider the tax impact, then it's right around that 3-year mark, just over 3 years.
Okay.
When you don't consider the tax impact, then you're talking, you know, then it's right around that 4-year mark.
Right. So just to help break that down for you some more, with a $104,000, again, just that minimum investment amount, 36 months of a $2,125 monthly income stream just comes out to $76,500. Dave says it takes a little bit more than 3 years. Plus, when you roll in your tax benefits, you get about that $104K back in just over 3 years. And then your last 3.5 or 4 years, that's when you're getting your return on your principal investment. So with 36 months worth of distributions, in that first 3 years, you'll have $76,500. And then your last 4 years, you would have $102,000, which would be your approximate pre-tax return on principal investment, where you're just getting that return of principal investment in that first 3 years or so.
I just want to make this real clear, because you can look at it like that, and it makes perfect sense when explained like that, but that's not really how it works from the eyes, let's say the IRS. You're not getting any of that principal or return of capital back. Remember, we talked about the value of the asset going down to almost zero? Well, it really does. So in the eyes of the IRS, the way you get taxed on this is, let's take the $104,000 investment. You take the depreciation over 5 years. So you're getting, on average, $20,800 per year of depreciation. So you take that $20,800 per year of depreciation, and that offsets, take $2,125 times 12 months, is $25,500 per year, $25,500 per year. So you're making $25,500 per year, and then you take the $20,800 of depreciation that offsets the tax liability on that cash flow. So you're getting about 70 to 80% of your cash flow is coming back to you tax-free in the first 5 years.
Nicely explained. We've talked about the fact that this is your most popular investment as measured by repeat investors that want to get back in. Have there ever been any cash calls in the history of the investment?
There's never been any cash calls, for a couple of reasons, but number one, there is no debt. So there's never been any cash calls. If your machine would just quit performing, the worst thing would happen, you would lose your investment. And let's say tomorrow the government would come out and say, we're not going to use cash anymore, we're going all Bitcoin. If that were to happen, you would lose your initial investment. So your real risk, if you're a high taxpayer, your real risk is in those first 3 years. After that, your risk is gone, because you know you really got all your cash back. So there won't be a cash call. Number two, we've never missed a monthly payment. And number three, we've never missed our projection, never missed our pro forma. In the history of the company, never had a cash call. We never missed our monthly payment. We never missed our pro forma or our projections.
And for those that don't know, a cash call is basically when a fund is running low on cash and they need the investors to make an injection of cash. Otherwise, the investor risks to lose their investment. They have no history of that happening. If you, the investor, think cash is going to become completely extinct in 2 years or 4 years, which I think we all know is extremely unlikely, well, then this investment would not be for you.
Yeah, and I would also say, I always try to figure out, okay, who is the investor? Who am I talking to? What's important to them? If you're looking for an equity play, this is not the one. There's other asset classes that we have available that is primarily equity plays, give you some cash flow along the way, but your big bump comes in the back end. This is not one of those. This is strictly a cash flow play, and it's strictly tax play.
I don't currently know of an investment that provides a greater cash on cash return than this one, 24.5%. So Dave, just talk about the timing of this. If someone wants to get in soon, how soon is funding due?
So we are open for investment. We have some units available in July. You would need to get your request into us. We would send you documents and wiring information. Our target date for the close is the end of June, with the closing being July 15th. So if you're interested, I would say number one, educate yourself on the space. If you are an accredited investor, this opportunity is only available to accredited investors.
Okay, so the funding for this next tranche closes June 30th. That's when you would have to have your funds in. The tranche closes on July 15th, and then you'd have your first payout November 25th, and then the 25th of every month thereafter.
Yes, for 84 months.
But if someone couldn't get in June 30th for the one that closes July 15th, they could do all of that a month later, get in on the last day of July for the tranche that closes August 15th, and then therefore the first payout would be December 25th and the 25th every month thereafter.
Assuming that we have units available, that is correct. Obviously, this is not an open-ended fund. We have a number. It was a big number. This fund was, you know, up around $15 million. But assuming that the fund is still open, we're not fully funded, that is correct.
And to review the definition of an accredited investor, since we have not talked about that on the show for a while, the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, has a definition for that. Basically, you are an accredited investor if you have an annual income exceeding $200,000 or if it exceeds $300,000 for married filing jointly couples, and they must have earned that for the last 2 years and have the expectation of earning the same or higher income in the current year. That's one way to qualify as an accredited investor. Or, and this is not an and, it's an or, you're also considered an accredited investor if you have a net worth exceeding $1 million. And that $1 million can be either individually or jointly with your spouse. And that figure may not include equity in your primary residence. And by the way, that's Rule 501, Regulation D from the SEC, if you're keeping score at home. If this piques your interest, I'd really encourage you to learn more about it by going to GetRichEducation.com/ATM and learning more about the investment and then connecting with Dave and his team. Dave Zook, any final thoughts on investing in automated teller machines?
Yeah, so we have a full investment summary, which will be available to your listeners when they go to that link. We are open. We're easy to reach. If you reach out to our team, we will respond. So any questions that you may have in regards to ATMs, we've got some literature here that we can send out to you. We can spend some time with you on the phone to walk you through it. If it's something that we didn't cover in this interview, if we didn't cover it in our reading materials, we're happy to help.
Dave, I think this is a really interesting topic. The fact that cash use is a growth business and this cash flow centric opportunity for investors with ATMs. Thanks so much for coming back onto the show.
Thanks for having me back, Keith.
To review what we discussed earlier, prefabricated and 3D printed homes have very real hard costs of materials, labor, and the underlying land cost that any other home does. Many industry organizations predict housing price increases nationally of 4% year over year. Cash use is increasing, not decreasing. Next week on the show, there is no guest. You're going to get a big dose of me. It will just be you and I here. Thanks to our guest, Dave, today. If you're an accredited investor that's looking for cash flow and tax benefits, learn more about investing in ATMs at getricheducation.com/ATM. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. Don't quit your daydream.
Nothing on this show should be considered specific, personal, or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate tax, legal, real estate, financial, or business professional for individualized advice. Opinions of guests are their own. Information is not guaranteed. All investment strategies have the potential for profit or loss. The host is operating on behalf of Get Rich Education, LLC, exclusively.
Countless investors get killed on their long-term maintenance costs in their rental property portfolio. But that's far less likely when you buy brand new construction. Let me tell you about my friends at JWB Real Estate Capital in Jacksonville, Florida. They pioneered the build-to-rent model that allows clients like you to invest in new construction, turnkey rental property. That's why JWB has been featured on the front page of the Wall Street Journal and other national media. If you want new construction rental properties in your portfolio, talk to JWB. Give them a call at 904-677-6777 or visit them at newconstructionturnkey.com. The preceding program was brought to you by your home for wealth building, GetRichEducation.com. getbook.com.